In 2018, at the Badongo Central Forest Reserve in Uganda, chimps were expecting an addition to the family. Everything seemed to be fine, but when the baby was born, the adult chimpanzees started panicking. The baby could cause trouble to the whole group because he turned out to be an albino. But was this baby really that dangerous? Let's find out. Are you done? It's just that he wasn't featured in the intro of the last videos, and as you can see, he really wants it. Are you happy now? So, what was it with that chimp baby? It was absolutely normal in terms of physiology. Four legs, ears, eyes. At the genetic level, this is also exactly the same chimp as everyone else. It's just that there was an error in its genome. You know, someone inherits a house, a car, or a bank account from their parents, while albinos get one or more mutated genes from both parents. These genes interfere with the body's production of melanin, the main pigment that determines the color of the skin, fur, and eyes. Non-mammal animals can also be albinos, but not all white animals are albinos. Some just have light skin and fur, while others have a mutation called leucism. But the fact still stands, other animals are wary of their albino kin. Seems like I found out why. When the first pair of adult chimps in Badongo Central Forest Reserve encountered an albino infant, they began producing alarm hoos and wah barks, screaming and running away. Over time, the number of concerned adult chimps began to grow, and this led to a sad conclusion. Just a few days later, the little chimp met its end. Fear turned into aggression, and the other chimps simply dealt with the unusual baby. This behavior surprised scientists. Usually, chimps react with curiosity to newborns, touching and grooming the infants, and also grooming their mothers. In some groups, animals may show aggression, but fear? This is something new. Perhaps the reason is that the white coloration of chimps resembled the color of eastern black and white colobus monkeys, who are the natural enemies of chimps. Colobus monkeys prey on chimps, and the latter certainly know about it. At the same time, colobus monkeys are also primates, which means they have a similar smell. In other words, in the area you consider home, you suddenly see a creature very similar to your sworn enemy. How else would you react to this? Although colobus monkeys look more like skunks to me, but who am I to argue with chimps on this? But even when animals don't have white or black and white enemies, they still often try to steer clear from their albino kin, just because the life of an albino in the wild is a real challenge. They often have poor vision, which means problems during the hunt or when you're trying to avoid being hunted. It's hard for a white animal to disguise itself under almost any conditions. They're just walking targets for predators. No wonder albinos have trouble finding a mate. Well, animals hardly know exactly how genetics work, but they have a good grasp of the principle: successful mate, successful offspring. An albino roe deer can hardly be called successful. There's always a risk that cubs will inherit an unnecessary gene. Of course, this doesn't mean that all offspring will be 100% albino, but who would want to check this? After all, having trouble with hunting or being hunted is not the only problem. Albinos hardly realize this, but they are highly valued among poachers. And when I say highly, I mean that the bounty on them can be 10 times that of regular animals. The exact amount is quite difficult to find because, well, you know, poaching is an illegal thing. In Scotland, a Wye roe deer was spotted, which most likely suffered from leucism. That is, it wasn't even an albino. They offered more than $7,000 for information about its whereabouts. That is, they offered money for the opportunity to shoot it. An albino corn snake can fetch about $500. Albino alligators are an even more valuable trophy. In 2008, seven of these reptiles were stolen from the Brazilian zoo. They were said to be worth $10,000 each. $10,000! White tigers have been hunted so intensely, they went extinct in the wild. Today, these animals with leucism are found mainly in zoos. But this doesn't stop hunters. They're willing to pay up to $60,000 for a chance to hunt one of these rare animals, which is 10 times the bounty for a regular tiger. Honestly, I don't think it's okay to kill everything odd you spot. Are we living in the Victorian era again? Of course, not all people act like this. Moreover, some are willing to spend a lot of money just to save albinos. Meet Alba, one of the rarest creatures on Earth. She's the only known albino in the dwindling population of Bornean orangutans. To protect Alba from poachers, the Borneo Orangutan Survival Foundation bought her an entire island for $80,000. Well, Alba herself and three other orangutans got the fenced and most protected part of the island. The rest will be occupied by scientists and security guards who will provide the albino with a comfortable and safe life. It's believed that here, Alba can easily live to be 50, climbing trees and eating fruits. In short, a life like in heaven. I'm even a little jealous. Hello, Steve. Remember me? You refused to go to the prom together? Well, now I have my own island. Bye. Two other females and one male that join Alba are the most common ones, without albinism. This also happens. Not every animal sees an enemy in an albino, but the best case scenario is when unique creatures get along well with their own kind. And the white squirrels of Olney are a great example. Olney is a small town in Illinois that boasts the largest number of albino squirrels in the world. There are several theories as to how the white squirrels ended up in Olney and why so many of them. Apparently, several people at once caught albino squirrels in the forest, kept them at home for a while, and then had to release them. In the city park? Correct me if I'm wrong. Anyway, albino squirrels are Olney's prized possessions. Nothing threatens them here. Ordinary squirrels are clearly in the minority. It's forbidden to walk dogs and cats without a leash or harness. There are feeders on the streets, and vets are always ready to help if any animal gets hurt. The fact that albinos feel comfortable in Olney is largely thanks to the people. Also, a huge number of white squirrels ensures no one will consider you an outsider, since everyone around you lacks melanin. And then I thought, what if all people were albinos? I mean all of them. Throughout the entire history of mankind, would we survive? One of the key concerns for people with albinism is delicate, fair skin. To protect themselves from the sun rays, people all over the world could wear long garments, hats, scarves, veils. We definitely have invented sunscreen way before 1932. In addition, all cultures would most likely evolve to perform most of their daily activities in the dark. Life would have turned upside down. What about vision? Albinism often impairs it. So does this mean we simply would not have survived the ancient times? Not necessarily. Some people with albinism are skilled hunters. Perhaps we would use walking canes, seeing eye animals, or even echolocation to help us navigate the world. And don't forget that all people on the planet would see equally bad. We'd simply not feel we've lost something, which means we would adapt. These are all just theories, of course. To date, the only available and safe way to change skin color without surgery is carrots or pumpkins. Wait, what? It really works. Eating too many beta-carotene-filled foods can turn your skin an orangey color. Oranges, mangoes, sweet potatoes, all this can cause skin discoloration. You'll first notice it on the palms, then the rest of the body. Of course, this won't happen right away. You'll need to eat 20 to 50 milligrams of beta carotenes per day for several weeks, with an average carrot containing about 4 milligrams. That makes about 10 carrots a day, but I don't recommend checking this one yourself. By the way, this seems to work even with the pregnant. If the future mother eats too many foods with beta carotene, her baby will be born orange. Can't claim it with certainty, but I, for example, was born just like that. Thanks to the mom and her love for carrots. Well, such color changes are completely pointless. Only animals really know how to put it to good use. There's a theory that says global warming makes animals lighter because dark color absorbs heat better. Nobody wants to get too much heat. Don't forget about camouflage. Essential for the survival of the animals, the ability to quickly change your appearance is often the only way to escape predators. Take chameleons, for example. Not the fastest creature that could hardly flee. In such a situation, the ability to switch between different colors in a matter of seconds is simply priceless. Well, everyone heard about the chameleon, but how do you like this frog? Perrin's tree frog makes a high-pitched cackle that's sometimes called maniacal laughter because, well, it really sounds like laughter. This frog can also change color with incredible speed. It can go from pale greenish-gray to reddish-brown with green spots or become almost completely white in less than an hour. Quite long compared to the chameleon in its 20 seconds. But hey, the frog can at least jump. How did the animals survive before they learned to change colors? I decided to find out and discovered an amazing fact. About 600 million years ago, seeing colors didn't matter so much to Earth's inhabitants. Nobody had eyes. The animals just floated around, aware of the existence of sunlight, and that was enough for them.
Listen, Steve, have you ever wondered what color we are?
We're red.
What's red?
No idea. Perhaps these great-great-great ancestors of modern fish and other creatures had a certain color, but who will tell us about it? You know what? Scientists have no idea what color the animals used to be. We can only speculate. But no one dares to come forward and confidently say the Diplodocuses were purple with orange spots. Until now, we haven't found well-preserved skin of any dinosaur that would allow us to make conclusions like that. Most often, instead of leather, we only get an impression. All scientists can do is base their assumptions on creatures with feathers and insects because they preserve pigments better, so we can't know for sure. What if once our planet was inhabited entirely by albinos? See you later.